Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back again, once again, to another session of Learn from the Masters. Today, we'll be having evaluation of pupil lens disorders by Dr. Sowmya. It's a very important topic, not just for the DNB students, but also us practicing ophthalmologists. Over to you, Dr. Sowmya.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. As we know, everybody who gets into ophthal subspecialty or even as a medical specialty or as a neurologist, the first and foremost important thing comes into mind as of pupil and how do you evaluate and its disorder. So we will be discussing about evaluation of the pupil in detail and the disorders as well. The overview of the talk would be whenever we talk of any evaluation, we should know why we are actually interested in doing the pupil. Two, we should also know, is there any particular order that we should follow whenever we are evaluating the pupil, primarily to get the maximum information in one go. And two, it is also to understand if there is any particular way so that we don't miss on the findings and end up with wrong diagnosis. We also look at various reflexes, the light and near reflexes, the afferent pupillary defect, all about anisocoria, the most important topic for the DNB exams or the postgraduate student. And finally, sum it up all and then a take home message. So we start off understanding why do we need to evaluate the pupil. So the pupil is really derived from the Latin word, which means pupilla, which is a dollar in image like, also means that there's a small central black thing, which is in the iris. So what are the functions of the pupil? The first and foremostly, it regulates the amount of light entering the eye. So that means pupil is a variable structure or a kinetic structure. The amount of light entering into the eye or entering into the pupil varies according to the light in the ambient condition. It also depends on the emotional state of the individual and so on and so forth. Second most important function of the pupil, subserved by the pupil, is it reduces spherical aberration and chromatic aberration. The aberrations itself is a topic by itself, but most important role played by the pupil in the cutting down of spherical and chromatic aberrations is by the pupil itself. Thirdly, increasing the depth of focus. As we discussed in the last class about the strabismic evaluation, the depth of the focus also can be monocular, and the depth of the focus would increase whenever the pupil is much smaller compared to when it is larger, and these aberrations would play a role. Why do we need to examine the pupil? First and foremostly, it's an objective indicator of the light input. The amount of light entering into the eye would help us understand how do we get the objective evaluation of it is known by examining the pupil. It is also an important clinical sign in case of visual loss and a neurological disease. In this, we get on as we move along or understand the talk in per se. We know that the pupillary reflex is an arc. Whenever we are talking of a reflex arc, there is an afferent limb, there's a center, there's an efferent limb. So whenever we check the pupillary reaction, we're checking the pathway in total and thus getting invaluable information, not just about the eye per se, the retina per se, the optic nerve per se, but also about the various brain structures which are involved in controlling of the pupil. So why do we need to examine? Because this is a simple bedside clinic test which we could do to understand the light input inside the eye. The next coming on to what is the anatomy of the pupil. Whenever we're talking of the anatomy of the pupillary pupil, we have to understand it's a kinetic structure. So whenever we tell of it as a kinetic, that means it's regulated by something which is making it kinetic, which are basically muscles of the pupil, which are sphincter pupillae and dilator pupillae. And the sphincter pupillae basically is a radial structure, which is at the pupillary margin, which is controlled by the parasympathetic pathway. So this comes into play in the bright light. So this is important for us to understand that whenever there's bright light, what the muscle in the pupil which is acting is a sphincter pupillae. Whenever it is dark, which is the muscle in action, is a dilator pupillae, which is a concentric muscle which is in the periphery of the iris or the mid periphery of the iris, regulated by the sympathetic pathway, or which is mostly seen in the dark regulation. So what we understand by this is primarily that there are two muscles which are acting at two different lighting conditions, sphincter pupillae in the bright light illumination and the sympathetic controlled by the parasympathetic pathway, and a dilator pupil which is controlled by the sympathetic system acting in the dim illumination. So this variation of the illumination stimulates two different muscles of the iris, which in turn regulate the size of the pupil. So this becomes important loop whenever we are evaluating it. So we come back to this again later whenever we are, how do we evaluate the pupil size? So that's important for us to understand that in the bright light, it's a sphincter pupilla which is at work. In the dark, it is a dilator pupilla which is at work. Both of it are controlled by parasympathetic and sympathetic pathway respectively. Next, coming on to the pharmacology part of it. Whenever we're looking at pharmacology, we told that the sphincter pupilla is controlled by the parasympathetic pathway. What does sphincter pupilla do? Constrict the pupil. So whenever sphincter pupilla is stimulated, that is parasympathomimetic drugs are used, it causes meiosis. Whenever parasympathetolytic drugs are used, it causes mydriasis. What are the parasympathetolytic drugs or cycloplegic drugs, which can also work on the ciliary muscle, would be atropine, homotropin, and cyclopentolate. Tropicamide is basically a parasympathetolytic drug, not a cycloplegic drug. So these are the most commonly used to dilate the pupil and examine the fundus one, and also to get a cycloplegic refraction, a dilated refraction, as we have already, as we normally do in the complete eye examination. Then the next important drug which could cause a mydriasis are those which could stimulate the dilator pupil directly, which are sympathomimetic drugs, which are like adrenaline, atropinephrine, or phenylephrine. Phenylephrine is most commonly used in all our routine practice for a dilated fundus examination. Phenylephrine in combination with tropicamide, which causes both. That is, it inhibits the sphincter pupillae by tropicamide. It also stimulates the dilator pupillae by phenylephrine. The combination of it helps in dilation of the pupil completely. And the next important thing that we should understand is about drugs which cause meiosis. Again, drugs which cause meiosis would be those which are parasympathomimetic drugs in terms of acetylcholine, physostigmine, or etrophonium, or pilocarpine. Pilocarpine being the most important and most commonly used. Then we've got the sympatholytic drugs, which also can be used in terms of guanethidine or alpha-methyltropa. So these are the various drugs which can act on the pupil, which again become important when we are talking about evaluation of the pupil. So whenever we talk about evaluation of the pupil, what do we need in order to evaluate the pupil? It cannot be done in a brightly lit room. So it has to be done in a semi-illuminated room or a dark room preferably, and use a bright light. Whenever you're talking of bright light, whenever we use a torch, just shine the torch and put it on your hand. If it has a dark center, that means these lights are not suitable for evaluating the pupil. It should have a bright center. That is, the torches which give you a scotoma in the center are not the torches which can be used for a pupillary examination. I'd always evaluate when the patient is looking at a far away distance, not looking at near, because you are testing the light reflex separately and the near reflex separately. So there are four important questions that we have to answer whenever you are evaluating a pupil. Firstly, you're looking at the shape. Are the pupils round or they are irregularly shaped? Two, are the pupil size equal or unequal? If they are unequal, if the inequality is increasing or the inequality is increasing in light or in dark room. Three, do the pupils react to the light stimulus? Fourthly, if they are not reacting to light stimulus, are they reacting to near target? So there are four things that we have to answer whenever we are looking at the pupil. One, the shape. Two, the size. They are equal or unequal. If unequal, it is more in light or dark. Thirdly, are they reacting to light stimulus? If not, if they are not reacting to light stimulus, then you go and check the near target. So how do we record or how do we evaluate the pupil? There's an interesting study which was done by Fuzan et al. Earlier, which looked at how do we place the light and which should be the direction of the examiner's visual axis in order to get the maximum information of the pupil. This is how most of us do, that the light is shining on the pupil and the patient is looking straight ahead at the Snellen chart or any distant target, and the examiner is viewing on the same visual axis. We could also do it. They also compared this part of examination with the other things. That is, when the patient's and examiner axis are the same, but the light is shown from below. Thirdly, the light is shown exactly in the same axis as the visual axis of the examiner, but the patient is looking above. So comparing all the three gave equal information or comparable information. But the last one, when the patient is actually looking up and you're shining the torch directly onto the patient and examining the patient exactly in the same axis as that of the light, gives you more information. So this can be various ways of looking at the pupillary reaction. Why this becomes important, especially in the cases of strabismus. If the patient has a large XT, large hyper, the direction of the light shown can determine the amount of light reflex that you're getting. So if you have a large XT and you're shining on the exactly in the center and the eye is looking somewhere else. That means the amount of light entering the eye is actually less. And that's why you're getting a sluggish pupillary reaction than what the patient actually has. So the direction of the pupil, direction of the light that is being shown, the direction of the patient's visual axis and the examiner's visual axis all has to be in consideration whenever you're examining the pupil. Further, whenever we have examined the pupil, what are the parameters that we record? How do we record it? We record it according to size of the pupil and dark in the right eye and left eye. Normally, it's around between 6 to 7 mm or close to 7 mm. Size of pupil in the light, somewhere between 2 and 3 mm. Which is again equal in the right eye and the left eye, the reaction to direct light reflex, if it is brisk or if it is sluggish, and reaction to indirect, that's a consensual light reflex. Then if these two are sluggish, we do the next two steps in terms of reaction to near or dilation in the dark. So these are the various parameters that has to be recorded whenever we are talking of pupillary examination. So we look at each of these parameters. We told about the size, we told about the reaction for light and near, and the dilation and dark. So we discuss all of these parameters, how do we check them in detail before we go on to the disorders of the pupil. So the pupil size can be measured with the help of a pupillary gauge. So this is similar to, these are circles, or these are black circles, which are of varying sizes, normally in the gauge of 0.5 millimeter are most accurate for examining. These are also called as HAP scale. You can also use a handheld pupil camera or an infrared video pupillography, which gives an objective documentation, which could be reproducible as well. So these are the ways where how you check the size of the pupil. Then we go on with checking of the reflex of the light or the light reflex. Whenever we're talking of the light reflex pathway a little bit in detail before we move on. So whenever we shine the light on the, say when we are shining the light on the right eye in this particular patient, the afferent impulses, the light stimulates the retina both nasally and temporally, and these move on along the optic nerve, the decussate at the chiasma, and then move on with the pass through the optic tract. They don't reach the geniculate body. The pupillary fibers leave the optic tract even before they reach the lateral geniculate body, move on to the pretectal nucleus. From the pretectal nucleus, which is at the level of the superior colliculus in the midbrain, they send impulses to ipsilateral leading or vespal nucleus and the contralateral. So this is where the crossing over of the fibers, or so the decussation of the fibers happen. It stimulates both Edinger vespal nucleus on either side. From the Edinger vespal nucleus, it starts the efferent impulses. From there, it moves on through the oculomotor nerve or the third nerve, release in the ciliary ganglion. From the ciliary ganglion, it moves along the inferior division of the third nerve and supplies the sphincter pupillae through nerve to inferior oblique. So whenever we're doing the inferior oblique surgeries, this again becomes important. So from the nerve to the inferior oblique, it supplies the sphincter pupillae to the short ciliary nerves. What is again important here is the light is shown on the right eye. There is a reaction which is happening in the left eye as well. This is because of the impulses which from the pretectal, which has gone to the contralateral Edinger vespal nucleus. So this becomes important when we are evaluating. So whenever we are shining the light in the right eye and looking for the reflex in the right eye, it is called a direct light reflex. Whenever we are shining the light in the right eye, but looking for the reflex in the left eye, it becomes consensual of the left eye. So this becomes important whenever we are evaluating the pupillary reaction. So let's look at the direct and indirect right reflex a little more further. So in this picture, what we are trying to assume is when the light is shown on the right eye, there is equal constriction of the pupil of the right eye and the left eye. When we move on to the left eye again, there's an equal constriction which is happening. And then we come back to the right eye. So the second picture basically shows the direct light reflex of the right eye. Shine the pupil on the right eye and look for the pupillary reflex in the same eye. And when the third picture basically shows shining the light on the left eye and look for the pupillary reaction in the right eye. That is a consensual of the right eye. Why this is important? This becomes important if you're checking with one reactive pupil, which we'll discuss it a little later. So you looked at the size, we looked at the reaction. Now let's look at the near reflex. Near reflex is basically a triad. One, which has a meiosis. Two, convergence. Three, and the accommodation. So that's a triad of these three things. The afferent impulses remain the same. The light and the convergence stimulus reach the retina from the optic nerve, optic chiasma. The most important thing is that it reaches the cortex before it comes back. and it bypasses the pretectal nucleus, or it passes more ventrally in the pretectal nucleus, unlike the light reflex fibers which are passing more dorsally. So this becomes important, this ventrodorsal separation of the pupillary fibers, which are subserving the light reflex and the near reflex. The light reflex fibers being more ventrally and the near reflex fibers being more dorsally is important because in some of the reactions, that one of them would be affected, the light reflex or the near reflex. So the right reflex fibers are situated more dorsally and the near reflex fibers are situated more ventrally. This becomes important. So from there, it goes on again, passes via the third nerve. It also from the ciliary ganglion, it reaches both ciliary muscle for accommodation and sphincter pupillae for constriction of the pupil. So both of them it reaches onto, which becomes important. Again, from the ciliary ganglion, the amount of fibers which serve the ciliary muscles and which serve the sphincter pupillae are different. Which go to the ciliary muscle, to the sphincter pupillae, the ratio is close to 30:1. This again becomes important for us to understand a few of the reflexes which we will be dealing with later. So the near reflex is again, the two important things that you have to remember here will be the near reflex pathway is a little separate, or the pupillary fibers which serve the near reflex is separated from the pupillary fibers which are serving the light reflex. One, two, from the ciliary ganglion, the fibers which go to the ciliary muscle is more compared to that of the sphincter pupillae in the ratio of 30:1. So when we're testing the near reflex, what do we need? Again, it is important to test the near reflex only when the direct response is weaker. There is hardly any conditions which causes only the near reflex to be affected, the light reflex to be completely normal. If that happens, it's mostly that the patient is actually not reading or not converging to elicit the near reflex. So again, you do it in the moderate room light. Use an accommodative target rather than using a non-accommodative target. Don't add the light stimulus to the near reflex. So whenever we're checking the near reflex, don't add the light reflex or ask the patient to look at the torch itself closely to elicit the convergence. That will add two stimulus, one light reflex and the convergence both, and thus the near reflex may appear apparently larger, which is not actually. So that should not happen. And whenever the near response is more than the light response, we call it as a light near dissociation. And this is happening because the fibers are separated at the level of the pretectal nucleus, as we discussed earlier. Then whenever the near response is added, don't add the light stimulus to it. And what light near dissociation means is that the near response, which is generated in the moderate light, the reflex is much more stronger compared to the light reflex or the best light reflex that could produce. The last important component that we have to check whenever we are looking at the pupillary dilation is the pupillary dilation. What we are looking at here is dilation lag. Normally in the dark, what happens? The pupil starts dilating. It starts dilating immediately as and when we enter into a dark room. And this time limit to attain the maximum dilation is usually between 12 to 15 seconds in a normal individual. The maximum amount of dilation occurring within 5 seconds. Unlike in a dilation lag, whenever it is present, that means what? It dilates, but it dilates very, very slowly. It takes more than 10 to 12 seconds to start dilating, and it reaches the maximum dilation only at the end of 25 seconds. So presence of a dilation lag is again an important clue for diagnosing various pupillary disorders. So we looked at the size of the pupil. We looked at in the dark, in the light, and we looked at the light reflexes. We looked at the near reflexes. We also knew how to check the dilation in dark or to check the presence of a dilation lag. Now let's look into physiological variations, the most important being physiological variation in the size, which is called physiological anisocoria. 3 millimeter pupil of the right eye need not mean that the left eye also has to be 3 mm to call it normal. It may be different by close to 0.4 to 0.5 millimeter. A size which is different in the two eyes, less than 0.5 millimeter, is physiologic. One, the physiological anisocoria would be the same in the light and dark, maybe slightly more in the dark. And three, the reactions are going to be completely normal in the right eye and left eye. If the reactions are normal, the size difference is less than 0.5 millimeter, and there is no dilation lag, we conclude that it's a physiological anisocoria and doesn't need more evaluation. The other physiological variation could happen, that is in terms of reaction, which is called hippus. The normal rhythmic pupillary oscillation, that means whenever there is a bright light shown for more than 6 seconds, it starts dilating and constricting. This oscillatory movement is called as hippus. And the abnormalities of the pupil, we classify into afferent pupillary defects, anisocoria, and abnormal shape. We'll be discussing the first two only. Abnormal shapes are an extension of the structural abnormalities of the eye, which we'll not be dealing with. Looking at the afferent pupillary defect, we already discussed about direct and light consensual light reflex. The same thing happens here. Consider an example, if there's a left optic tract lesion or an optic nerve lesion, what happens? Direct reflex of the left eye is going to be gone, and the consensual of the left eye is going to be brisk. So that means direct with respect to the direct reflex of the left eye is gone, and consensual of the left eye is going to be present, which we call it as, compared to the right eye, this eye has a afferent pupillary defect, which we call it as a relative afferent pupillary defect, relative to the other eye. If there is an afferent lesion or an optic nerve lesion in both the eye, we just call it as a an APD, that is afferent pupillary defect. We don't call it as a bilateral RAPD. There is no condition called as a bilateral RAPD. RAPD implies that there is a unilateral lesion which is more affected compared to the other eye. So whenever we are talking of RAPD, we need to understand what do you mean by, or how do we test it? That is by the help of swinging flashlight test. What do we mean by swinging flashlight test? That means we shine the torch in front of the right eye for 3 seconds, then alternate it to the left eye for 3 seconds, then keep alternating between the two and look for the pupillary escape, which happens in the eye with the lesion. So whenever we shine the torch in front of the right eye, it constricts, but when we go to the left eye, the direct reflex is absent in the left eye. So it's going to dilate. The other eye is also going to dilate. So this is how we check the swing or confirm the presence of RAPD, which is also called as Marcus Gunn pupil. What happens if the pupil is not reacting? Imagine that the left eye has a bound down pupil for any reason, and we are not able to elicit any pupillary reaction in the left eye. Can we still make out that the left eye has an RAPD? Yes. If for checking of the RAPD, we just need a one working pupil. So the right eye is a working pupil. Left eye has an optic neuropathy. It also has a bound down pupil for whatever reason. Now what happens is, normally, when we're checking the reflexes for the left eye, we're looking at the left eye. So now what you do is, this is the only working pupil, concentrate only on the right eye. When we shine the light on the right eye, look for the pupillary constriction in the right eye. That means direct of the right eye is normal. Now shine that light on the left eye, but what we will look for is, look for the right eye only. It is undergoing dilation, which should normally undergo constriction if the other eye pupillary afferent pathway was normal. So by looking at this, only the one of the working pupils, we can still diagnose an RAPD in the other eye, which has a bound down pupil. So how do we grade RAPD? Grading of the RAPD was first given by Bell et al. And we do a swinging flashlight test and look at the reaction. If there's an initial weak constriction with a greater dilatation later, that's a grade 1 RAPD. Then the grade 2 RAPD, there's a stall followed by dilatation. If there's an immediate dilatation, that's a grade 3. Grade 4 undergoes dilation even after a long periods of illumination also, the pupils still remains dilated. That means it's a grade 4. Grade 5 was suggested by Bell et al., but we don't normally use it. And so we grade it. This is qualitative grading. This could vary from individual to individual. So can we grade it more quantitatively? We can do it with the help of neutral density filters. We can use it computerized pupillography. You can also use an interesting thing, which is called a Bagolini filter bar, tested in some of the studies. So these are the Bagolini neutral density filters. And neutral density filters are usually named in log units. 0.3 log units to 3 log units are available. What we normally use is 0.3 to 1.8 log units. And how do we check it? We place the neutral density filter in front of the normal eye. The left eye had RAPD as we were discussing earlier. You place the neutral density filter in front of the right eye and do the swinging flashlight test till the responses become equal. That means that we are inducing an artificial RAPD in the normal eye by placing a neutral density filter. Still, the reflexes become equal in both the eye. We continue doing a swinging flashlight test. With whatever filter that we are able to elicit this, that becomes the grade of the RAPD. We place the neutral density filter in front of the normal eye is what is important to be remembered. Can we compare the two? Yeah, there are a few studies which compare the two, where the grade 1 correlates to around 0.6 and grade 4 correlating up to 2 log units of neutral density filter causing the RAPD. So we diagnosed RAPD, we graded it as well. So what are the causes of RAPD? RAPD can be caused by the afferent pathway defects. That means there's a large lesion at the macula, the optic nerve lesions, the optic chiasmatic lesion, or the optic tract lesions also can cause an RAPD, where the optic tract lesion causes a contralateral RAPD. Can we have an RAPD in the absence of a visual loss? Yes, it can happen in certain conditions which affect the pretectal nucleus at the level of the superior colliculus, which can affect only pupillary fibers, not affect the fibers which are subserving the vision then it can cause a contralateral RAPD without visual field loss, which becomes important. So now once we knew about the afferent pupillary defect, there's another reaction which can happen in the pupil with respect to the reflexes, which is called paradoxical pupillary phenomena. What we said earlier was, in the dark, the pupil starts dilating. If the pupil starts constricting and then starts dilating, that is called a paradoxical pupillary reaction. That means when the patient enters dark, it constricts first, then starts dilating. It's called paradoxical pupillary phenomena. When does it happen? It happens most commonly with CSNB, which is congenital stationary night blindness. It can also happen with congenital achromatopsia. It can also happen with optic nerve hypoplasia. So rarer causes will be LCA or Best disease or RP. So this paradoxical pupillary phenomena important when we are assessing low vision in case of infants, when we can't get the other things assessed. So that is why the pupillary reaction becomes important. Next, coming on to anisochoria, look at this child. This child has a pupil. The left eye pupil looks much smaller and the right eye looks dilated. So we don't know which of the pupil is normal, which of them is abnormal. The smaller pupil is abnormal or the larger pupil is abnormal. So when we have already discussed about physiological anisochoria, where the size is lesser, there's no dilation, it's same in light and dark. So we look at size, reaction and pharmacological tests in order to differentiate the two. What becomes more important is, whenever we are dealing with anisochoria, the first and foremost important test is what we look like, the order of evaluation, size of the pupil in dark, size of the pupil in light. When we look at both the things, what we are looking at is the anisochoria more in bright light or is the anisochoria more in dim light? Whenever it is more in bright light, what it implies is the parasympathetic pathway is at fault. Whenever it is more in dim light, it implies that the sympathetic pathway is at fault. If it is more in the bright light and parasympathetic pathway is at fault, it's usually that the larger pupil is abnormal. If there is an increase in the dim light, that means the smaller pupil is abnormal. So we have understood, just by looking at the size of the pupil in the light and dark, we get to know which of the pathways affected, which of the pupil is affected, the larger or the smaller pupil. Then go on with our order of evaluation. The next would be the reflexes and the near reflexes and the dilation. So first, let's discuss something about the parasympathetic path. Just like look at this video, the same child, when we shine the light, what happens to the child is there is hardly any light reaction which is happening in the right eye compared to the left eye. I'm sorry that the reaction may not be seen very clearly. And then when we look at the near reflex is completely or mostly normal. It has started constricting again. So whenever we have a condition which has pure light reflexes and the near response is normal, that means there is a tonicity in the pupil. We call it as a tonic pupil, which is caused by the damage of the postganglionic parasympathetic fibers. Tonic pupil has four important features. One, the light reflex is very, very poor or sluggish with segmental iris palsy. Two, it can have accommodative paresis, which slowly improves. Three, it has an unusual or a tonic near reaction and a slow dilation after constriction to the near stimuli. That means that a near reaction is very tonic, slow to constrict, slow to dilate, and also slow to constrict. And there is a hypersensitivity reaction. So in the tonic pupil, it can happen because of various causes. It can happen because of local causes, or it can happen because of neuropathy causes, or it can happen because of the Addis pupil as well. So whenever we're talking of local causes, So whenever we're talking of the, So whenever we're talking of the tonic pupil, we can look at multiple things. The local causes could be the orbital causes which can happen. The orbital causes being herpes zoster ophthalmicus or a local trauma and things like that. And when we are talking of systemic causes, which is bilateral tonic pupil, which becomes a very important entity because we're dealing with much more complicated okay. when we are looking at more complicated systemic conditions in terms of we're looking at more complicated conditions like maloficial variant of the Guillain-Barré syndrome or GBS, Charcot-Marie-Tooth syndrome. So whenever we're looking at bilateral tonic pupil, bilateral pupil which are dilated, not reacting to light, but reacting to near, always look for systemic conditions like peripheral or systemic autonomic neuropathy. If both the conditions are excluded and has no cause, it's an idiopathic condition, we call it as an Aedes tonic pupil. So Aedes tonic pupil has all the features of tonic pupil. What did we see? One, light reflex, which is poor, segmental iris palsy, there's accommodative paresis, which slowly improves, and there is a near reaction, which is tonic, and there is hypersensitivity. So whenever we're looking at the tonic pupil, we look back to the video again, what we were discussing. We said that the light reflex was poor in this child. We also looked at the near reflex, which is normal. Whenever we're checking at near reflex, we could also use an accommodative target and ask the patient to read. We're using a pen here to elicit the reaction so that I could get a better video. But more importantly, it's better to use an accommodative target. We also look at the other thing, that is a segmental iris palsy, which is also called as vermiform movements of the iris. If you actually look at this video, there is parts of the pupil which are reacting, parts of the pupil which are not reacting, and the pupil is dilated, mid-dilated, and sluggishly reactive. So these are the other features, segmental iris palsy or the vermiform movements of the iris, which we look on the slit lamp. And what happens, why there is segmental iris palsy or why the accommodation fibers come back later is because of the fibers, postganglionic fibers, which is serving the ciliary muscles with this versus the sphincter pupillary muscles, which are in the ratio of 30:1. So whenever the aberrant regeneration happens, it's the fibers which are going to the ciliary ganglion, which gets misrouted to the sphincter pupilla. So the near reflex, which is elicited because of the accommodation, comes into play while the light reflex fibers don't come into play. So that is why there is light near dissociation. The Aedes pupils becomes bilateral, so unilateral to begin with, becomes bilateral nearly 4% per year. Whenever, as the natural history progresses, it becomes smaller and smaller, which was dilated earlier. It could also have deep pinon reflexes, which are absent, then we call it as a Holmes Aedes syndrome, which becomes important for your viva point of view in the postgraduate exams. So whenever, where there's anisocoria, which is more in bright light, it is a parasympathetic pathway effect. So look at the slit lamp examination, rule out the causes like a acute raise in the intraocular pressure, which is an acute angle closure glaucoma, which could have a dilated and mid-dilated pupil, or it could be posterior sinica, which is caused by uveitis. Once you have ruled out all these causes and you have looked at segmental iris contraction, which is present, what do we do? You do a 0.125% or 0.1% pilocarpine test. How do we do it? Take 1 cc of 1% pilocarpine, mix it in 8 ml of normal saline or tear drops, and instill it in both the eyes of the patient and look for the constriction of the pupil. So when do we look for it? 30 to 45 minutes after the instillation of the pilocarpine drops. Whenever it constricts, it's an Aedes pupil. If it is not constricting, then you move on and do the next test. So whenever we have an Aedes pupil, that is light reflex, which is lesser, near reflex, which is there, segmental iris contraction, and hypersensitivity to 0.125% pilocarpine, like what we see in this picture, this patient actually has a right eye, which is dilated, right Aedes pupil. And this is the constriction which happens after 0.1% pilocarpine. Similarly, in the other patient, which had a bilateral Aedes, which constricted after 0.125% pilocarpine. So whenever there's no reaction to this, we do a 0.1% pilocarpine test. 1% pilocarpine test is to rule out the other possibilities. What are the other possibility? If it reacts to 1% pilocarpine, it is a third nerve palsy. Whenever we're talking of third nerve palsy, there are also associated findings that you have to look for, that is limited ocular movements or the presence of ptosis and things like that. Then there is no change, then it is in the form of pharmacological mitriasis. That is because of the drugs that the patient has used it up. So to sum up, anisocoria implies that there is an efferent pathway which is at fault. If it's in bright light, it's a parasympathetic pathway. Look for light near dissociation and look for test like pilocarpine test, which is 0.1% or 1% to diagnose Aedes pupil. So this is how the parasympathetic pathway that we have dealt with. The other causes of light near dissociation could be, Aedes pupil is one of the most important causes of light near dissociation. Second most important is any cause which causes a severe visual loss in terms of optic neuropathy also can cause a light near dissociation. Most importantly, that you have to remember, the Argyle-Robertson pupil. Argyle-Robertson pupil has a light near dissociation. These pupils are smaller, irregular pupils, and And they also have a very, very poor dilation. So Argel Robertson pupil, the lesion of the, is at the level of the tectum of the midbrain or pretectal lesions. This again becomes important when we are dealing with dorsal midbrain lesions. There's another condition which is called pseudo-Argel Robertson pupil, which occurs in the presence of aberrant regeneration of third nerve. That means here the pupils are not having a light near dissociation, but the patient starts having a pupillary constriction whenever the eye adducts. So the fibers which are serving the medial rectus have gone into sphincter pupillae. So that is what causes a pseudo-Argel Robertson pupil. The next important thing is to look at if there is an increase with sympathetic pathway, that is increased anisochoria in the dim light. Whenever we're talking of sympathetic pathway, what do we have to remember? Again, we go back to the pathway. What is the pathway for the dilator pupillary muscle? It has a first order neuron. It starts at the hypothalamus, descends along the midbrain, where it is closely linked to or very very closely related to the fourth nerve, which becomes important again. Relays in the ciliospinal center of Birch, which is at the level of CA to T2. This becomes a first order neuron. Second order neuron starts from here, passes along the apex of the lung, reaches the superior cervical ganglion, which becomes the second order neuron. From the superior cervical ganglion, it gives the third order neuron, which it passes along the third nerve and supplies a dilator pupillary muscle. These fibers also give pseudomotor fibers or vasoconstrictor fibers to the face, one half of the face, which follows the external carotid artery, unlike the dilator pupillary fibers, which follow the internal carotid artery. So this relations becomes important whenever we are investigating or when we are diagnosing it. So let's look at what happens. This is the size of the pupil in the bright light. This is the size of the pupil in the dark illumination. So there's anisochoria, which is more in the dark light. Whenever the anisochoria is more in the dark light, which is the pupil at fault, the smaller pupil is at fault. There's also an amount of ptosis which is there. Look at the lower lid also. So these are the features of the Horner syndrome. There is reduced palpebral fissure. There's an upside down ptosis because the sympathetic fibers also supply the inferior tarsal muscle. So this lower lid becomes a little higher. So that is what we call as an upside down ptosis because there is narrowing of palpebral fissure. There's pseudo enophthalmus. There's smaller pupil. This is meiotic pupil. There's a dilation lag, which we discussed earlier also. Whenever the sympathetic pathway is affected, the dilation lag is present and the accommodative also can get affected. So whenever there's Horner syndrome, that is the anisochoria, which is worse in the dark, we look at and confirm the diagnosis with the help of the pharmacological test. The first and foremost important test is to confirm the diagnosis. We use a cocaine test. Cocaine is not available, so you can use an apraclonidin. How do you differentiate a first order, second order neuron, which are clubbed as preganglionic lesions, and a postganglionic, which is a third order neuron, with the help of hydroxyamphetamine test and denervation test with topical adrenergics. So let's look on to one by one. In the presence of cocaine, what does cocaine do? It blocks the reuptake of norepinephrine at the sympathetic nerve subsystem. So it prevents the reuptake. When it prevents a reuptake, that means the norepinephrine has to be present if the pupil has to dilate with cocaine. So in the presence of a normal, look at this patient again, the same patient which we were talking about. This is how the patient is looking at. And this is after the instillation of cocaine. When we put the cocaine in both the eye, examine the patient after an hour, the normal pupil dilates, whereas the abnormal pupil, which is in the left eye, does not dilate. So the normal pupil will dilate with cocaine and abnormal pupil or the Horner's pupil will not. So cocaine worsens the anisochoria, which we have seen. So it helps in confirming the diagnosis. Whenever cocaine is not available, we use the apraclonidin. Apraclonidin is basically an alpha agonist. Alpha agonist means what? It stimulates the eyes. It's like a denervation hypersensitivity. This gives reactions which are exactly opposite of cocaine syndrome. So look at this patient. This patient has a left Horner syndrome. So after the instillation of apraclonidin, what has happened? The ptosis has reversed. The pupil has dilated, and like the other eye, which is not dilating. Why this does not dilate? Because this does not have a denervation hypersensitivity. So apraclonidin causes a reversal of Horner syndrome. And this, that's how we differentiate or confirm the diagnosis with apraclonidin test. So to sum up both the things, in the presence of, this is a left Horner's again, in the presence of cocaine, the Horner syndrome pupil does not dilate. In the presence of apraclonidin, it does dilate with the reversal of ptosis. That's how we confirm the diagnosis. The next important thing is, the hydroxyamphetamine test, how do we confirm the preganglionic and postganglionic lesion? So the hydroxyamphetamine releases the stored norepinephrine from the postganglionic adrenergic neuron. If the postganglionic neuron is intact, that means the paradrine will cause a dilation of the pupil. Otherwise, it will not. Look at this patient. The patient has a right eye Horner syndrome. When we put hydroxyamphetamine in both the eye, this pupil is dilated. This is not. The anisocoria is still worsening. So that means it's a postganglionic lesion. So postganglionic Horner syndrome does not dilate with hydroxyamphetamine. And the other test which we could do is with the epinephrine test, which is like a denervation hypersensitivity. So what did we do? So the firstly, we looked at the smaller pupil, which is the abnormal pupil because the anisocoria was more in the dark. We did cocaine or aplacronidine test to confirm it. We did hydroxyamphetamine test to confirm which is a preganglionic or postganglionic lesion. The other important factor that you have to remember in the presence of a Horner syndrome is look at fourth nerve palsy. If there is a fourth nerve palsy, along with one side fourth nerve palsy, one side Horner syndrome, this gives you a clue to localize a lesion at the level of the trochlear nucleus, that is at the level of the midbrain or the fascicle, because we said that the sympathetic pathway is close to the fourth nerve at the level of the midbrain. Second, this is very close to the, it runs along the internal carotid artery, whereas sixth nerve is closely located, especially in the cavernous hemisphere. So if you have an ipsilateral sixth nerve palsy with an ipsilateral Horner syndrome, so the lesion is at the cavernous hemisphere. If the patient presents with an acute painful Horner syndrome, always, always rule out the presence of dissection of ICA or internal carotid artery, which is the most commonest cause, and it needs an emergency intervention. So we looked at various causes and we looked at the pathway. So the first order neuron starts at the hypothalamus, comes to the neck, that is at the ciliocinal sphincter of the birch. So any lesions there, thalamic lesion, Wallenberg syndrome, cervical spinal cord lesion, all causes first order lesions. Second order neuron passes along the apex of the lung. So any lesion which affects at the apex of the lung, a thyroid lesion or the neck lesions, usually cause second order neuron lesion. And the third order neuron is along the common carotid artery. So common carotid artery dissection or sclerosis or cavernous sinus lesion should cause a third order neuron lesion. So it's very important to investigate a case of Horner syndrome. What are the investigations that you'll order? Depends on where we are localizing the lesion. If there is no localization, which is possible, so what do we order for? We order for imaging of the head and neck, which covers both common carotid artery and the hypothalamus and midbrain lesion. We also order for the neck lesions to rule out this. So CT or MRI with of the brain neck chest with or without CT angiogram would help in diagnosis of Horner syndrome. There are a few things which are important about congenital Horners. There is hypochromia, which occurs on the side of the lesion in a congenital Horners. Two, second important thing is second order neuron damage behaves similar to postganglionic lesion in a congenital Horners. So differentiating a pre and postganglionic lesion does not hold good in a congenital Horners syndrome. Three, the causes are a little different. It's usually because of the birth trauma. The second most lesion which can cause this and causes a lot of problems is a neuroblastoma, which has to be differentiated or which has to be ruled out in any child coming with Horner syndrome. So how do we investigate this? Investigation is basically that you'll do, again, MRI of the head, neck and chest. Along with that, you also look for urinary catecholamines. Why this? To rule out neuroblastoma. So if this gives a conclusive evidence that probably the urinary catecholamines are positive, then you do a MRI of the abdomen in detail and MRI of the neck and the aortic arch. That helps in differentiating. Most importantly, rule out history of trauma, rule out history of birth trauma before we get investigations done. Do more common tests like urinary catecholamines, and whenever we are sedating the child, because it needs sedation to do MRI, do everything in total. MRI of the head, neck and chest, so that we don't have to repeat it if we don't get adequate answers with it. So to sum up, whenever anisocoria is more in dim light, it means the sympathetic pathway is at fault. That means the smaller pupil is abnormal. If the smaller pupil is abnormal, go ahead and do the cocaine test and aproclonidine test. You localize a lesion with a hydroxyamphetamine test. Investigating a case of Horner syndromes becomes very, very, very important, be it congenital or be it acquired, and treating according to the cause. So this concludes the most of the lesions in terms of parasympathetic pathway or sympathetic pathway. The other important thing that we have to remember is whenever we're doing a hydroxyamphetamine test after a cocaine test, we usually wait for 72 hours before we do it. That's the time which is required to wash out cocaine and elicit a hydroxyamphetamine test. So most of the times we don't wait for this to be done because it wastes 3 days of time. If the patient is having a carotid artery dissection or a cavernous sinus lesion, which are more emergency condition, we just confirm the test clinically, do an aproclonidine test to confirm, and go ahead and image the patient. The other pupillary reactions, which are less important, or why we said the pupillary reactions are important, or gives a clue into the neurological site evaluation, especially in case of comatose patient. In a comatose patient, if you have a pinpoint pupil, it most often tells you that the lesion is at the level of the pons. If there is a unilateral dilated and fixed pupil, it's mostly because of uncal herniation and the third nerve palsy being affected. If it's at the level of the midbrain or tectum, we get a agile Robertson pupil, as we were discussing earlier. And then we've got the diencephalon lesion, which could cause a bilateral Horner's syndrome. So looking at the size of the pupils also gives you a clue at localizing it, also helps at understanding what further investigations or what pertinent investigation can be done in order to save the life of the individual in some of the cases. Lastly, there are two other things that we need to remember. One is Wernicke's pupil, which is Wernicke's hemianopic pupil, which occurs in terms of bitemporal hemianopia because of chiasmatic lesion. So light falling on the nasal retina will fail to elicit the restriction, pupillary constriction. This becomes a little difficult. If you have a very pointed source of light, we could elicit a Wernicke's hemianopic pupil. The other abnormality is a tadpole pupil, which is related to the pupillary shape. This pupillary shape can be abnormal, and this is because of the dilator pupillary muscle undergoing constriction like a rhythmic action. So this is a benign phenomenon, doesn't need investigation. So to sum up, what we looked at is whenever we have anisocoria, we look at anisocoria, which is more in the dark. If it is more in the dark, look for the light reaction. If there is poor reaction to the light reflex or adequate reaction. If it is poor reaction, probably we're dealing with pharmacological meiosis. If there's good reaction, but there is a dilation lag, the dilation lag along with ptosis and upside down ptosis and in ophthalmos could give you a clue towards Horner syndrome. Do a cocaine test. Cocaine test helps in understanding the confirming a Horner syndrome. If cocaine test is negative, then it is a simple anisocoria or a physiological anisocoria. If it's positive, then it is a Horner syndrome. When it is Horner's, again, you differentiate with the help of pre or postganglionic with the help of hydroxyamphetamine test and concluded. If the anisocoria is more in the light, that means it's a parasympathetic pathway which is affected. So the most important thing that you will do is slit lamp examination. Slit lamp examination to rule out structural abnormalities of the iris or the pupil or the anti-lens surface which is causing a problem. Or there is a sectoral segmental iris constriction or vermiform movements of the iris. If that is present, then probably you're looking at Aedes pupil. Tested with the help of 0.1 patient pilocarpine. If it constricts, it's an Aedes pupil. If it does not, then you do a 1% pilocarpine test to confirm if it's a third nerve palsy. And if both of things are not present, or the pupil is not constricting with 1%, then we are dealing with a pharmacological metriasis. So take home would be, so pupil would be giving an insight into the visual pathway and various neurological disease. Always look for size of pupil in the light and dark as a first step in the evaluation. Then evaluate for the light reflexes. If the light reflexes are absent or sluggish, do the near reflex. When the near reflex is also affected or near reflex is brisk or there's a light near dissociation, do the pertinent pharmacological test to confirm the diagnosis. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sowmya. It's been a very nice and elaborate talk on pupil and its evaluation. We'll just take some questions. I think there's already one question. You're able to see it, Dr. Sowmya, then you can take it.
Yes, sir. Dr. Ranjini is asking, what is efferent pupillary defect and how to check it? See, whenever we're talking about efferent pupillary defect, as I was mentioning you, the pupillary reflex is basically an arc. It has an afferent pathway, it has an efferent pathway. Efferent pathway is whenever we're looking at, is looking at pupillary size and the pupillary reactions of it. So efferent pupillary defect will encompass both, that is parasympathetic defects or sympathetic defects. So that means that the patient could have either a Horner's or Aedes, all of them come under efferent pupillary defects. Or the patient could be having a third nerve palsy, which is also an efferent pupillary defect. So all the pathways which affect the efferent pathway come under the category of efferent pupillary defect. What is reverse RAPD? Whenever we're taking off relative afferent pupillary defect, we don't say it as a reversal of RAPD, primarily because the optic neuropathy, even when it recovers completely, we tend to have the RAPD which is persisting, which could probably reduce in its grade from the grade 3 or grade 4 could become a grade 1. Reversal of RAPD or a reverse RAPD is not something that I have we comment upon. Dr. Shriram is asking, is there a aberrant regeneration of third nerve palsy affecting pupil? How do we differentiate it? So that is what I was telling you, Shriram. Whenever we talk of aberrant regeneration of third nerve, there are various things that happen with the pupil. The what is a classical sign of aberrant regeneration of the third nerve affecting the pupil is called as a pseudo-agile Robertson pupil. When we said agile Robertson pupil, what we talked about is the near reflex which is there, the light reflex which is not there. There's a light near dissociation. But in an aberrant regeneration, it's not the light near dissociation. The pupils are not reacting to near, but it's what is happening is they are reacting whenever the eye is adducting. That means the fibers which were supposed to go to the medial rectus, they are aberrantly regenerated to the sphincter pupillae. So any adduction could elicit a pupillary reaction. So how do we know it, or how do you differentiate it from the true agile Robertson pupil or the light near dissociation? Is basically that you close one of the eye, look for the pupillary reaction on ductions. So whenever the patient is adducting, if you see a pupillary constriction, then probably you're dealing with a pseudo-agile Robertson pupil, not a true light near dissociation. So the next question is from Anand Dayal. What is the difference between near reflex and a convergence reflex? See, whenever we're telling convergence reflex, we are dealing with only one component, that is convergence. The convergence can have four different aspects of it. It could be proximal convergence, it could be fusional convergence, it could be accommodative convergence, it could be tonic convergence. So that is what we are talking about when we are talking of a convergence reflex. But when we are talking of a near reflex, that's a triad. There is not only convergence, which is accommodative convergence, not the rest of the three convergence that we talked about. There is also a meiosis of the pupil, that is because it's sphincter pupil, and there is also accommodation which is happening. So that is the near reflex, which has all the three components vis-a-vis a convergence, which is just a it's a vergence moment where both the eyes are converging, both the eyes are moving to each other in order to bring it in the focus. So what is the stimulus for convergence and what is the stimulus for near reflex is different again. When we have to elicit the convergence, what is the stimulus for the convergence is basically diplopia or double vision. When we are looking at near reflex, the accommodation part of it is stimulated with the help of blurred near vision, blurred vision. So blurring of the image or blurring of the object is a stimulus for the near reflex person. The next question is, can we use brimonidin instead of apraglutinin from Amar? Amar, brimonidin and apraglutinin, there's a study which is done, and brimonidin gives you a lot of false positive reactions, and that is why brimonidin is not used instead of apraglutinin according to the studies. I didn't specifically quote brimonidin, basically by the help of the studies that it shows a high amount of false positive reactions in brimonidin, and that could gives you and especially in cases of physiological and isochoria prompt you to do a lot of investigations which is not warranted. How do we check pupil reaction in dark? I'm not very sure I understand the question well, Chintan Vedia. Pupil reaction in dark, if you're dealing with the pupil size that I said about the dilation lag, what we do is basically dim the light, use a very, very moderate amount of light, just enough to see the pupillary size in both the things, and then place the torch inferiorly, ask the patient to look straight ahead in the dark room and look for the size of the pupil, and that's how you know that. Dr. Srinivas is asking, what is a practical way to check pupil size in dark, and that is in dark, that is in dim light? That is what I showed you. First, look for the pupillary size whenever the patient enters to you. We didn't discuss a lot about the history or the patient presenting complaints, basically for the want of time. So whenever you suspect there's a pupillary reaction, normally when we are doing an examination, the lights are on in your room. So just put a torch, not directly, below, and then look for the size of the pupil when the patient is reading the syringe. That gives you an idea about what is the pupillary size in the light. Then put off your room lights, and then ask the patient to continue reading and look for the pupillary size. That gives you the pupillary size in the dark. So that's how you note it. And the pupil, what you have to note it is not the maximum size it has attained. What you have to look for is the anisocoria getting worse in dim light or bright light. Two, the dilation lag if it is present or otherwise. So those are the two things that we are dealing with or important for us to diagnose this. Mahavir Khandarwar is asking, please tell me RAPD and APD are different or the same. Mahavir, whatever we are talking about, APD means there is an afferent pupillary defect, which could be in one eye or it could be in both the eyes. If it is in both the eye, it could be the same intensity or same affection in both the eye. It could be more in one eye or it could be lesser in another eye. So all of this is encompassed in APD. Whenever we're talking of RAPD, we essentially mean that the one of the afferent pupillary pathway of one of the eye is weaker compared to the other eye. So whatever reason. So, or the other eye pupil can be completely normal, only this pupil is affected. So, whenever you're talking RAPD, it means that the optic nerve pathway or the afferent pathway of one of the eye is affected compared to the other eye. We are telling in relation to the other eye. That is what we mean. Can we elicit RAPD in the presence of corneal opacity in one eye? Raj Priyadarshi, as we, what we were telling about is the same thing. Whenever we have only one working pupil, when we or only one pupil where we could see the reaction, we could still check the RAPD. Imagine the patient has a RAPD in the right eye and the corneal opacity is there in the left eye. Okay, we could still elicit it because we know that the corneal opacity, if it is very dense opacity, absolutely not letting any amount of light inside the eye, can give you a false reaction. But in most of the cases that you will have one clear area through which you can shine the light and can elicit the RAPD in the other eye. Or if you have the same eye which is getting affected, if the corneal opacity is also there, RAPD is also there in the same eye, that is in the right eye itself, and still elicited, looking at the comparing the direct reflex of the left eye with the consensual of the other eye. So that's how we grade the RAPD, or you can elicit the RAPD. Dr. Joy is asking, is cocaine, apraclonidine, hydroxyamphetamine available in India? What can we use instead? Cocaine is not available. Hydroxyamphetamine is also not available. Apraclonidine was available earlier, so that is what we most commonly use. But more importantly, rather than the pharmacological test, what we rely upon is the clinical clues to the same, especially in children where we can't elicit all this test. Checking the reflex with a torch with yellow light or white light, does it make any significance? I'm not very sure because I am not very sure of any studies being conducted using a white light or a yellow light with a white light. In all possibilities, it should not make any difference because we are not dealing with the color of the light. It's the intensity of the light that does make a difference. Probably that could hold good only in cases of children when you use a very bright white light. We might not be able to elicit any kind of a reaction because the patient may have a strong or the patient's having photophobia. Maybe you can have a problem. Drugs that you have advised, are they controlled drugs? Sorry, I don't understand the question. If you're talking of the availability or if they are FDA approved, yes, they are approved and can be used in our patients. And Tarika is asking, post-cataract surgery, we see iatrogenic irregular pupil. How do we assess the pupillary abnormalities in such a situation? See, again, whenever you are assessing the pupil, Tarika, that is what I was mentioning, you have to follow a particular order. Whenever we're looking at any pupil, you look at the size of the pupil, you look at the reactions of the pupil, you look at the near reaction and the dilation lag, and look at the problems. If it is an iatrogenic irregular pupil, look for the structural, look for the first the size of the pupil, and look for the size in the light and the dark. Also look for the slit lamp examination. If you see a sphincter tear at any point of place, or you have an iris atrophy or an iris chafing in that area, you know that's a structural problem. So they have already ruled out a structural possibility. So those are the causes for your irregular pupil. You need not investigate it further, or you need not do any other test further. If none of the abnormalities are there, and if it's the first post-op day, seen say in the early morning and you have operated late afternoon, just give it a little time to allow for the wearing off of all your dilating drops that you have used, is reassess it back in the evening, and then take it forward according to whatever protocol that we were mentioning. Nitya is asking, is it possible for a ventral midbrain lesion to affect only ventral fibers and cause only near reflex to be affected while sparing the light reflex? Very unlikely, Nitya, because whenever we're talking of the light reflex on the near reflex, the near reflex to be gone only completely without the light reflex being affected is very, very highly unlikely to happen, because the ventral lesions, when we have talking about the reflexes, the number of fibers which serve the light reflex are much more compared to those serving the near reflex. One and two, the ventral fibers to be affected alone without the dorsal fibers or something like a ventral midbrain syndrome is unheard of. So probably that is why theoretically it should be possible, but not very sure about it.
I don't see any more questions, is it?
No, sir, I'm not able to see the questions.
I think that's about it, I guess. And it's been a wonderful talk and nicely and elaborately covered everything in Pupil. I'm sure everybody would have benefited by your talk. Thank you very much, Dr. Sowmya.
Thank you, sir. I hope everybody enjoyed the session. And hope all of you are staying safe. Take care. See you again in the next class.
Yes. And for our next session, we'll be having a session on retinoblastoma. It'll be taken by Dr. Mahesh Shanmugam, who is a vitreoretina consultant and head of Department of Retina Services at Sankara Eye Hospital. And the time remains the same. It's from 12 o'clock to 1 p.m. The link of the Zoom link might be a little different, which I'll be sharing subsequently as the before the session starts, and the YouTube the channel remains on. Thank you, everyone, and
thank you,
have a safe weekend. And stay safe, and see you on Monday.
Thank you, Dr. Sowmya. Yeah, thank you. Bye.